텔아비브로 가는 일본 국도를 타고 가다 보면 예루살렘에서 한 17km 지난 지점쯤에 오른쪽에 기랴앗 여야림이라고 하는 곳이 있습니다. 다윗왕 때 법궤가 잠시 머물렀다고 하는 곳이죠. 바로 그곳에 이스라엘에서 유일하게 메시아닉 공동체가 운영하는 키부츠가 있다고 합니다. 그 키부츠가 지금은 호텔을 운영하고 있는데요. 바로 야드하시무나라고 하는 곳이죠. 경관도 좋고 조용하고 또 주변도 아주 아름답고 해서 저도 이스라엘 올 때마다 이곳에 와서 차를 마시며 또 주님과 만나는 그런 시간을 갖곤 하는데요. 특별히 이 야드하시무나 공동체 키부츠가 핀란드 국가와는 특별한 인연이 있다고 합니다. 도대체 이 야드하시무나 어떻게 또 메시아닉 공동체들이 이곳에 호텔을 운영하게 되었는지, 그리고 지금 이곳에서는 어떤 놀라운 기적과 같은 일들이 일어나고 있는지 그런 이야기를 들어보도록 하겠습니다. 지금 제 옆에는 메시아닉 빌리버죠. 메시아닉 주이시면서 또 이 야드하시무나의 홍보 담당으로 계신 아얄렛 레논 양께서 제 옆에 계십니다. 어서 오십시오. 고맙습니다.
Thank you very much and welcome to Yad HaShemuna.
우선 야드 하시무나라는 이름하고 제가 조금 전에 얘기했던 그 핀란드하고 깊은 관련이 있죠. 그 얘기를 좀 우선 설명을 해주시죠.
Yad HaShemuna means memorial to the eight. Yad in Hebrew is a hand, hand to something, memorial to something. And the eight Jews that we are called upon are eight Finnish Jewish refugees, actually Jewish refugees that escaped from Central Europe to Finland during Second World War, and Finland handed them over to Nazi Germany to be taken back to Auschwitz, and they died in Auschwitz, except one of them that survived and later came to Israel. And because of that stain on the Finnish people, that thing that the Finnish people had a part in, the founders of Yad HaShemuna wanted to have in Israel a village in memory for those eight Jews.
8명의 유대인들이 핀란드로 도망갔다가 또 그 이후에 핀란드 사람들이 이곳에 키부츠를 만들게 되는 어떤 연관이 있을까요?
Yad HaShemuna was founded by a very small group of Finnish volunteers, people that came from Finland, to be a volunteer in regular kibbutzes in Israel, around the land. It was during the 60s, and Finland actually sent to Israel hundreds of volunteers to come and help to build the Jewish state of Israel. Some of those small group of Finnish people decided to go to the Israeli government with a very strange request. And the request was to found in Israel a Finnish kibbutz, a kibbutz of Finnish people. At the beginning, people told them this doesn't make any sense because the land of Israel is for the Jewish people. We don't give land for non-Jewish people. But the founder of Yad HaShemuna and the whole group, they insisted. And their request went all the way up to Golda Meir. Golda Meir was the prime minister of Israel. And Golda Meir is the one that gave her agreement, her approval for a founding in Israel of a Finnish kibbutz. And this is how the whole story started. We don't know exactly why she said that, why she said yes. It's a unique once in history case. But what we do know is that the Golda Meir, before she was the prime minister of Israel, she was the ambassador of Israel to the former Soviet Union. And Golda Meir knew that Finland has a part, has the desire to help in bringing the Jews out of the Soviet Union. So we think this is the reason. So those small group of people, this small group of people, there was no church behind them, no organization behind them, no state, nothing. Just their own vision and prayers to God. Nobody was behind them. So everything was done by their own two hands and power and prayers. They began to put down water system and sewer system and roads and to build small huts for them to stay in. This was at 73, 74, they received suddenly the papers to go with this place to say, yes, you can start a village. They went back to Finland. They sold houses and cars to bring the money to build. And along the way, some Finnish people came and saw this group and helped them along the way. And it was about 5 to 10 years after the Finnish start, that the first Israelis joined them. The first Jewish Israelis joined them. And Seppo Raulo, the founder of Yad HaShemuna, he hosted in Yad HaShemuna one very small youth messianic conference. The Messianic Youth Conference. It was up here on the hilltop. And he came to some of the guides, the counselors of the course, and he said, you know, we need Israelis to come and help us to build this place. If not, we are foreigners. We're not really from here. And my uncle was the first one to come and join it, Eli Bar David, and then my father and his brothers and some more Messianic believers joined. And over the years, it became more dominantly Messianic Jewish village and less Finnish, because after a while, Ministry of Interior began to say, no more. No more for these non-Jews. They don't have a reason to be here, so they didn't give extra ability for people to stay. So altogether, we're not big. We're about 250 people living here in this place, about 55 families. But God has done amazing things in this place. And the reason it's so amazing is because you have people that live together as a kibbutz, like you said. We are what we call in Hebrew, Moshav Shitufi, which is a communal village. And it means that it's a system of life that everybody in Israel knows. Very familiar. Israelis know what the kibbutz is. Israelis know what Moshav means. So when they come here, it's not like they're coming to a ministry or to an office or to a group of people who are trying to influence them. They're really coming to visit a regular village of people that have a very specific faith. And that is the faith in Yeshua, our Messiah. And it opened over the years amazing doors for us to share about Yeshua.
조금 전에 이제 말씀하셨는데 그 키부츠, 저는 키부츠라고 설명을 했는데 모샤브라고 이야기하셨어요. 키부츠와 모샤브 어떤 차이가 있습니까?
In Israel, we have a variety of ways to settle. And this is the official title of the place. We have from a kibbutz. Kibbutz during the 50s, 60s, 70s was completely socialist system. From there, you have all the way to what we call Moshav Ovdim, or a village of workers, a village of farmers. Okay, in the middle, you have the grades of socialism, basically. We are very close to the kibbutz. It's called Moshav Shitufi, communal village. And there is a reason for that. When Seppo Raulo came, the founder of Yad HaShmona, the Finnish man, in order to be a kibbutz, he had to sign up with the kibbutz movement in Israel. You have to sign your name in the kibbutz movement settling program. And because they didn't know who he is, what is this Finnish group of people, they didn't want to accept him as a kibbutz. So he signed up, he wrote, he registered Yad HaShmona as a communal village, Moshav Shitufi, which is also very common in Israel. In the first years, we were very much like a kibbutz. All the income of everybody would go to the general pool, and everybody would get an equal budget. This is the kibbutz system. Everything in this place belongs to us communally until today. And people used to work here or work outside, bring the income. The main thing, though, is that decisions are done together. In the kibbutz, you collect the general assembly of people and you make decisions on the major issues together. And this is, for many years, this is how the kibbutz system existed, and we were the same. We were a Moshav Shitufi exactly of this kind. And many times it's something I like to tell believers from around the world. When you think about it, the first church in the book of Acts was very much a kibbutz as well. They brought everything together. They shared everything in one heart. And I can tell you, as believers, also the founders of Yad HaShmona and the Israelis here had the same idea, the same attitude, to really share not just this land and this place, but the vision and the workforce. Not me for myself and you for yourself, but us together to build something that is bigger than the individual. And there is a lot that we do together. This place is hosting children camps and youth camps and messianic activity. And we have groups of religious people coming to the biblical garden. We have children from different schools, soldiers who come here. And when they come to visit, we can share about who we are. And it's a very, very special door, open door for us.
오늘도 와서 보니까 그 많은 유대인들이 와서 무슨 이벤트, 성인식을 하는 것 같더라고요. 장소도 제공하지만 호텔도 운영하고 있는데 다른 데하고는 다르게 예수님을 믿는 예수아를 믿는 메시아닉 빌리버들, 메시아닉 주시들이 운영을 한단 말이에요. 그러면은 이스라엘에 있는 다른 호텔이나 다른 이 컨퍼런스 장소에 비해서 운영하는데 무슨 차이점이 있습니까?
First of all, the hotel belongs to Yad HaShmona. Yad HaShmona is a village. The main thing is the village. Inside of it, we also have a hotel. And all the kibbutzim in Israel are under the legislation. It's under the rule of what we call the cooperatives. Yad HaShmona is a cooperative, a registered one. So the way we act legally needs to be very much like the legislation of the cooperatives. And we do that. But Yad HaShmona is special, and because we're believers and the hotel is inside the village, we are limiting the type of activity that's happening at the hotel, and it's not an easy thing in Israel. So we don't allow people to get drunk or to drink alcohol in, you know, in a party kind of way. We don't allow belly dancing, disco, you know, parties to the middle of the night, yoga, seminars. There's a lot of stuff, a lot of people that want to come with all kinds of ideas, and we are constantly limiting that, which makes it very difficult when you run a hotel in Israel. The things people, Israelis, want to come and do in a hotel is not the best. And many times we ask ourselves, well, why do we need this? Why do we need this? You know, we can turn it into, I don't know, an academic center or something. But we feel that through the hotel, God opened an amazing door for us, for hundreds and thousands of Israelis to come and hear about this special place. Not just the special place, that's not the point, but to hear about Yeshua. And that's why we feel that God is keeping it going. But yes, it's a special hotel in a special village.
그런데 제가 듣기로는 몇 년 전에 동성애자들이 여기 와서 결혼식 하고 싶다 이렇게 신청을 했는데 그거를 알고 야드 시모나 쪽에서 그걸 거절했다가 아주 큰 어려움을 겪었다라는 얘기를 들었습니다. 그 얘기를 좀 해 주시죠.
So one day we received a phone call. The woman at the reception received a phone call from a woman, very nice woman, and she wanted to check if a certain date was open for a small wedding celebration. This is what she said. And the woman at the reception answered the phone and she said, "Yes, the date looks okay. And you can come or ask me later about details." And when that woman called the next day, or a few days after, our receptionist realized that she's talking about a gay couple. She said, "Me and my friend," and she said it in a, you know, in a female term. And she said, "Wait a minute." The receptionist said, "Wait a minute. No, we can't do weddings like that. We're a Bible-believing place, and the hotel also, and we cannot have a wedding like that." The woman at the phone was very upset. And immediately she called one of the top lawyers in Israel, that it's a woman also that deals with gay and lesbian rights. And very fast, within a few days, we already knew that they're suing us for breaking the law. Now, what is the law? In Israel, the law is an anti-discrimination law, and it's defined as anti-discrimination based on your religion, your race, your color, your faith. And a few years ago, they added sexual affiliation. Okay? So now, just from a few years ago, we're breaking the law because businesses in Israel are supposed to serve everybody in that sense. Also, if somebody comes as a gay, you cannot turn him down. Now, we knew that. We knew that. But it was more complicated than that. The trial or the lawyers were trying to say, wait a minute, but there are other freedoms in our democracy that needs protection. For example, the freedom of religion. So if you have a group of believers, of, you know, Finnish Christians and Jewish believers in Jesus, why force them to have a wedding like that? And not only that, we asked ourselves, would that gay couple go and have a wedding in Mea Shearim? Would they go and have a wedding in Bnei Brak, you know, the center of the ultra-Orthodox religious people? They wouldn't. The trial was a very difficult one, not just because of building the case and, you know, the complexity of the law and all that, but it also received a very high coverage in the news, in the radio, in TV, in the newspapers. We received many hostile phone calls from gays and lesbians saying, "You're homophobic, you hate people, you claim to love the world as Jesus says." That's what somebody said to us. "You claim to love the world as Yeshua says, but then you hate gays and lesbians." And we had a chance, on one hand, to explain something here, you know, suddenly to stand and to say, "No, we love people, we love everybody. But God's message is something to do with sinful behavior. It's not loving the person. It's about sinful behavior, sinful choice in God's eyes. And not only that, it's not our opinion. We have the scriptures. We have the Bible. It went on and on and on, the trial. We lost the trial, and we had to pay a very high fine, high for Yad HaShemona. It was expenses of the trial and also the fine. And we received some help from wonderful Christian people. But then it wouldn't go down. It kept coming to the media and to the attention of the people in a very interesting way. On one hand, now that there is a decision by the court that we broke the law, there were gays and lesbians calling our reception saying that they want to come to get married. So within a week of the court's case, we decided we don't have any more weddings in Yad HaShemona. And that was quite a shock, I can say, because we used to have beautiful weddings here. We had religious people come and get married in our biblical garden. We had, you know, believers who got married here. Secular people. People love this place. It is conservative, but it's beautiful and it looks biblical and the view is beautiful. And so we cut weddings altogether immediately. And this brought down some of the income of the hotel, but it wasn't just that. People came really with the intention to kind of stir things, you know, to cause trouble. On the other hand, we received a lot of supportive phone calls from religious people in all over the country. People saying, good for you. You stood on your faith. This is a complicated case. We are losing this front. And I think there is a feeling many times among believers that the front of the gay and lesbian community in Israel, I think around the world, not just in Israel, it's like a battle that nobody wants to get into. It's too sensitive. People don't want to claim or to sound homophobic or to sound primitive and all this. And we just let society go in that direction. And I had a chance to tell people many times, the biggest missionaries in the world today, in my opinion, are the gay and lesbian community. Because what they're trying to do is to create more. There is more. If you make it public, if you make it acceptable, young people get the choice to say, wait a minute, maybe I have another choice. Not just straight, I have something else. And this, not just, it's not something that I believe we have to stand for, but really to take it as a path to point to God's morals, that God's morals is something that men cannot change, really. And it really influenced our hotel for a while. But you know what? At the end of the day, it brought a lot of blessing. I believe we saw it. God was standing with us through the process. And until today, we have people that come here, even though we don't have the weddings, and Israelis that love this place.
동성애자들은 그렇다 치더라도 오늘 보니까 이곳에서 그 성년식을 치르는 사람들이 이제 일반적인 유대인들인데 정통 유대인들도 온다면서요. 그러면은 그 정통 유대인들이 이곳에서 성인식을 하거나 일반적인 유대인들, 예수님을 믿지 않는 일반적인 유대인들이 이곳에서 성인식을 치르려고 할 때 아, 여기가 알고 보니까 예수님을 믿는 메시아닉 빌리버들이 하는 곳이네. 이런 것 때문에 행사를 하려고 했다가 취소를 하거나 뭐 충돌이 일어나거나 그런 문제가 일어난 적은 없습니까?
We had only one time a major resistance, and it was a neighboring village. They came close to Yad HaShemona, suddenly, you know, tens if not hundreds of people from the religious ultra-Orthodox village by us, Kiryat Yarim. They came with flyers that Yad HaShemona are dangerous and that we are missionaries and all these things. But most of the time when people come here, they come to our territory. They come to our land. And when they ask and we tell our story and we say that we believe in Yeshua, that Yeshua was not just Jewish. He spoke only to our people, never left the borders of this country, came as a Messiah. Once they are in our land, in our territory, usually, even if there is a resistance, it's a resistance of a conversation, okay? Like, I don't agree with you. What's this nonsense? You know, this is something I hear a lot and we hear a lot here. But there is curiosity together with us, and people are with that, and people are curious to hear what do we have to say. And many times I see that the desire to hear is bigger than the objection, okay? And it's very interesting. It brings about very open heart-to-heart discussions. We don't force anyone to come. They can always leave. Sometimes people come and turn around and go. And I want to say that when people come to the hotel or to eat, we don't walk around and give them New Testament. It's their choice to come and ask. Actually, it's in the village, in Yad HaShemona, that we get more the conversation, the openness and the conversation with parents around in the schools, the teachers. We have 40 kids every morning going on the bus of the municipality to the local school. 40 kids to a secular school. You can imagine that everybody there knows that we're believers in Yeshua. And we share. We invite the teachers. We invite the principals. We try as much as possible to be open about who we are. But I have to say, we do it in a gentle way. We are not for any, you know, spreading of papers and stuff like that. Personally, that's our personal opinion here in Yad HaShmona. We believe in mouth to ear to ear. In the long-term testimony, when people see you, see your children, see the soldiers, see the students, see the life over many years and think to themselves, is there really something in the message of Yeshua in the New Testament?
그리고 제가 알기로는 한 10년 전인가 이 Yad HaShmona 가 있는 이 장소 주변에 있는 산에서 아주 큰 산불이 일어나서 이 Yad HaShmona까지도 굉장히 위험에 빠질 뻔한 적이 있었는데 아주 놀라운 기적 같은 일이 일어난 적이 있었다고 그러더라고요.
Actually, it happened twice. In the year 95, there was a big fire. And again, now, just 3 years ago, there was a big fire coming up from the west in our area. You could actually see the burned mountains. When you look around, you could see the spots of the gray, you know, flamed fire, and it was moving. You could see the move because of the wind. It was very scary. In Yad HaShmona, we have equipment. We actually have a team out of the men in Yad HaShmona. The problem was that there were so many fires in Israel in a short time that they didn't have enough fire trucks to send everywhere. So we could see the fire coming. There were no trucks coming at some point. So here we have a team of men who are very, you know, very with a desire to protect and to help. And they already got organized with some things. And in a miraculous way, the wind changed direction. Wow. When it was very close to Yad HaShmona. The neighboring village right over the mountain in the north of us, there is a small village called Nataf. And the fire surrounded Nataf and began to burn the houses there. There were some houses burned. And Yad HaShmona team went over there to help. And then something really nice happened. And at night, because the fire was, you know, very strong around the village, they evacuated all the people from Nataf. And where did they come? To us. The mayor of the municipality called us and asked if we can have the people of Nataf. So there were about 150 people here coming to the hotel until the fire was off. So we felt that we can at least help others also in this situation. And I can tell you today that what we are working on, we don't have, but what we want is a water pipe around Yad HaShmona. This is our prayer, something to invest, but it's a major investment. But the water pipe around Yad HaShmona, so if it will happen in the future, we will be able to stop the fire lower and not when it comes to the top of the hill. We are sitting on the hill.
지금 우리가 서 있는 곳이 Yad HaShmona에서도 이 비블리컬 가든인데 여기 앉아 있거나 여기 이렇게 걷다 보면은 정말 2000년 전에 이스라엘로 돌아온 것 같은 그런 착각이 들고 저쪽 끝에서 예수님이 나를 향해서 이렇게 걸어오실 것 같은 그런 착각이 드는 그런 장소예요. 이곳에서 하나님의 임재하심을 느끼는 장소다. 이렇게 자랑하실 수 있죠.
I can definitely say that people feel the presence of God. We have people that come and sit in the biblical garden and they read the verses and they come and they see even the children running in the moshav and they feel that there is something different. And I think many times it's not the words of our mouth. It's really the actions. It's really the testimony. And it opened a lot of doors to share. And yes, we want them to come and enjoy and feel the presence of God, like you're saying. Especially the biblical garden, the whole idea is for people to meet the life of the Bible time as it was. You know, the oil press, the wine press, the synagogue, you know, the watchtower. Really, not many years ago, this is what Israel looked like. And Jesus lived it. Jesus was a man with sandals and a working hands. You know, he wasn't out of a Da Vinci, a Da Vinci art. He was a real Israeli man walking on this land. And I believe seeing these things, seeing and feeling it, connects people to the presence, to the reality of the presence of Yeshua in this land. Yeah.
한국의 크리스천들도 여기 많이 옵니까?
Not as many. I think Koreans don't know Yad HaShmona so well. We have a few times, and we also have volunteers from Korea sometimes. We still have a volunteers program, but not many. We want to have more Koreans come to this place and visit and see it.
저도 1년에 몇 번씩 이제 한국에 우리 브레드 TV 시청자들과 함께 이스라엘을 방문하는 그런 프로그램을 갖고 있는데 전에는 예루살렘 시내에 있는 호텔만 굳이 가려고 이렇게 애를 썼는데 다음부터는 이곳 야드 시모나에 와서 자는 것도 좀 우리가 생각을 좀 해봐야 될 것 같아요. 그래서 우리 한국의 크리스찬들뿐만 아니라 전 세계에 있는 모든 크리스찬들이 이곳 야드 시모나에 와서 이 아름다운 곳에서 이스라엘 온 땅을 향해서 우리가 높게 하나님을 찬양하고 그런 날이 왔으면 좋겠습니다. 우리도 앞으로 자주 오겠습니다.
Sure. Welcome.
이스라엘에서 예수와의 신앙을 지키고 이 야드 시모나라고 하는 키부츠를 운영해 나가고 있는 우리 키부츠 야드 시모나의 우리 믿는 자들, 메시아닉 주들을 응원하고요. 앞으로 우리 또 브레드 TV 시청자들과 함께 이곳에 방문해서 우리 아일렛과 함께 또 예수와를 함께 히브리어로 찬양하는 그런 날이 왔으면 좋겠습니다. 다음에는 아일렛 개인의 이 신앙 이야기도 좀 들어보는 시간을 가졌으면 좋겠습니다. 어쨌든 오늘 이렇게 귀한 시간 내주시고 귀한 곳에 초대해 주셔서 너무 고맙습니다.
Yes, thank you. 또다 가봐. Thank you very much. Dear friends in Korea, brothers and sisters, I am Ayelet. I'm here from Yad HaShmona, and we are welcoming you to come to this place for one time, to skip the Jerusalem Hotel or the Tel Aviv Hotel and to come here to the Judean Mountains and share a time with us in the special Moshav of Yad HaShmona. Welcome.